I don't think there's much debate about whether Assassin's Creed Origins is a good-looking game. It is stunning. From sweeping deserts to lush marshland environments, Assassin's Creed Origins plays its cards right. But being a console title predominantly, the developers and artists needed to squeeze all the juice out of your Xbox or PlayStation that they could. And one of the ways they do this is by using low detail geometry in smart ways. So in this video, I'm going to cover a few different tricks that are used by Assassin's Creed Origins and a lot of other games to create low poly geometry that still looks good and helps to trick the player into thinking there is more graphical detail than they might think. And I thought I might keep it centralized and contextual by getting all of these tricks from this farm. I am warning everyone now. Most of what we're about to cover is things that you cannot unsee. So if you aren't the kind of person that likes to look behind the curtain, then don't say I didn't give you a heads up. Hey, this is Guy de McDee, and you are watching Design Run, a casual series of videos where we break down the design of one game in particular. Let's get into these tricks. Number one is the good old crossed planes trick. One of the oldest tricks in the book for 3D geometry is to use crossed planes to create objects with a lot of fine detail cheaply. This works because we don't consider things like trees as objects that have a lot of detail. We look at the whole and process it as a tree, which is why when we get a crude drawing like this, we still know instantly that it is a tree. Taking this idea, games have been creating trees by having a modeled trunk and flat planes with leaf textures on them for ages. Here's some footage from Jak and Daxter, a game that came out from the start of the PS2 lifecycle, although this footage is from the PS4 port. Running down like this, everything looks fine, but if we stop and really scrutinize the vegetation, you can easily see that it's a lot of flat, low poly geometry. Assassin's Creed takes advantage of this all over the place. The trees are the obvious one, mixing up the angles and directions of this low poly branch geometry so that from a distance it looks like leaves. But getting close up, you can see that even the berries are part of the texture on the branches, and they disappear as you get perpendicular to them. Similar techniques get used for the crops and these flowers. From the angle of the third person camera, it looks pretty good, but when you swing overhead, the illusion falls apart a little. These little white flowers actually gave me a bit of trouble to work out. But if we take out our predator bow and look down along the edge of the field, I think what is happening is the stem is made up of strips, which we'll discuss in a second, and the bulb slash flower at the top has two little planes with the flower texture that move independently in the wind, which turns out very convincing. Number two, thin peels of geometry. So similar to number one, a lot of these props have solid low poly bodies and then thin peels of geometry sticking out the top. Then the detail work is achieved mostly by the texture. This set of bales is solid and looks pretty good, but once again, if we swing over the top with the camera, the effect becomes very obvious. But from the angle that the player will have the camera most of the time, this will look great and perform well too. There is a similar thing going on with this hay fence, where the bottom is modeled as normal geometry with dimension, and to add detail without blowing the poly count out of the water, strips are again used to add the detail in at the top where the ends of the hay would lean over. This technique is also used for things like ferns or palm trees to give that feel that the leaves are leaning over under the influence of gravity, which also adds natural dimension without increasing the amount of geometry. Number three is taking advantage of terrain textures. You can see around this fire that the heat has burnt the ground in places. Well, ash is one of those things that we consider as a whole, rather than as individual pieces of ash. So here it looks like the artists have taken advantage of the terrain running underneath the fire. So terrain is usually a massive flat tile that gets adjusted and molded into the shape to form the ground for the world. And then to detail it, most game engines have a set of brush tools that you can load a palette of textures into. These then get painted onto the ground to create things like paths. Here it seems the artist used an ash texture and just painted under the fire to give the illusion of scorched earth. And the only additional asset would be the texture. This technique could be used for all sorts of things though. Number four, mesh warping. Hay bales you can hide in like this are a staple of the Assassin's Creed universe, but that doesn't mean that they aren't subject to low poly tricks. If you look at this hay bale as I hide in it, you can see that the top of the mesh bobs to sell that interaction. Combine this with some hay particles and it's a pretty satisfying action. But when you look at the mesh of the hay bale, it's pretty simple, and the warping and the texture are doing most of the work to sell that interaction. Similarly, when you run through the flowers and crops, etc., they look really good when you are sprinting through them. But if we slow down and really consider what is happening, you can see that there seems to be a small sphere at Bayek's feet that interacts with the plants, warping the mesh around the sphere and then pushing it underneath the terrain surface. This looks silly when you walk slowly at the edge of the field, but that mesh deforming around the sphere is what makes running through the flowers look so good. Sell it with some cheeky hand animation and these low poly planes are starting to come in really handy. Number five, texture warping. I think it's worth talking about this awning for a second for two reasons. The first is, I think the artists are getting a lot of realism out of simply folding over the edges like they have and tucking it up in the corners. It adds dimension and realism to the awning that otherwise is just flat geometry with a texture. The other trick they use is easy to see if you jump up on top of the awning. The awning itself does not sway in the wind. Instead, the texture on the awning warps ever so slightly. I'm not an artist, so I don't fully understand the tech behind this, but that subtle warping of the texture is what the devs are using to try and sell the idea that wind is running underneath this cloth. Another trick we can use to help detail our environments. Last but not least, number 6, combining things together. We have already quickly went over the idea of a tree having a bunch of fine detail, but being processed by the brain as a whole. Well, we can use this idea for the props that we scatter around our environments. These bags of what I'm going to guess is grain look quite low poly. You could chuck them around everywhere by themselves, or you could stick them on top of something else, place that next to something else again, tie it all together with some rope, and you have a bunch of low poly objects that the player will process as a whole, like supplies or cargo. Similarly, these cucumbers or pickles or whatever they are look okay, but are fairly low detail. But if we use a bunch of them and tie them to a broken crate, it makes no sense. I don't know why you would want to do that, but it looks and feels like a new object, and you are less critical of each one's individual detail. And it doesn't have to be random stuff either. Here is a bunch of brick-only assets that have a small story behind them as a whole. You can see they even use some assets that are chunks of 4 or 5 bricks, this one and this one. And so I hope you liked those little observations. Subscribe to the channel and like the video, and I'm sorry that this video is late this week. I have a bunch of next week's video done already, so back to the normal schedule on Fridays. And keep an eye out for a channel update in a few weeks, as things will be changing for a month or two over April and May. Thanks everyone, and see you Friday.